We are the only country in the world that can stop that. The Israelis, in my opinion, do not have the capability of stopping it. They can delay it. There will also be many, many side effects, all of them adverse, from an Israeli strike. But at the end of the day, if we don't get it done the way the administration's working on it now, which I totally agree with, then we ought to take them out.
Secretary Clinton.
Well, we're working hard. We're working hard.
So I'm here in Tehran. Been here in Tehran for almost a month, actually. This is the Shah's old compound where he lived in opulence. There's 13 palaces here. And so he took the land and he turned it into this opulent, luxurious residence for him and his guests like Jimmy Carter and so forth. Anyway, I was invited here for the Hollywoodism conference, which was a fantastic conference. Coincidentally, as I've stayed here beyond the conference, Argo is just one best picture. If you haven't seen Argo, well then you've missed one of Hollywood's latest propaganda pieces. It starts off looking like it might tell some real truth about America's relationship with Iran, but what little truth exists in the beginning minutes of the film turn into the same old tired propaganda.
We will begin the trials and carry out the sentences.
We wonder where and how and the endless parade of hatred will end. What do they want?
Get us to
say the question should be not what, but who. The answer to that is clear. They want the former Shah's
to talk about human rights. Carter and his government have given asylum to the worst criminals
for life. They will remain until the Shah is returned.
One main point, however, that film fails to mention, intentionally so, of course, is that the American embassy in Tehran was a nest of CIA spies. It was provably a den of spies because the documents seized when the students took over the embassy during the revolution of 1979, the documents proved that the Shah was, of course, nothing more than a puppet.
It's the most pleasant opportunity for the Empress and myself to be able, thanks to your very kind invitation, to visit your great and beautiful country.
I speak on behalf of all of my fellow Americans in welcoming you to the United States.
This is a great tribute to you, Your Majesty, and to your leadership, and to the respect and the admiration and love which your people give to you.
The Shah was working hand in hand with the American spies, CIA, and so on and so forth. There's so many other untruths in the movie. I could sit here and discuss that for some time, but it's the same old thing. Some other movies we discussed, Unthinkable with Samuel L. Jackson.
You're out.
Do we know if there's a way he could get his hands on fissionable material?
3 years ago, he was on a team checking nuclear facilities in Russia. The Russians can't account for 15 to 18 pounds. They can't be accurate. Around 5 pounds on each bomb, that's 6 to 10 million casualties, folks.
But do we have any direct evidence that this is real?
Tehran paid him $20 million to get nuclear materials out of Russia and into Iran. Then they lost track of him and the money.
How do you know that?
They told us themselves. They didn't want us using Younger as an excuse to bomb the crap out of him.
What does he want?
So let me tell you some truths about Iran, which the American people and the West in general are not told. First off, when it comes to nuclear weapons, see, let me explain this first. In the West, we find it hard, if not impossible, to imagine that we might have a leadership that we respect, because we don't have leadership that we respect. They're not leaders, they're puppets, they're prostitutes. Presidents and prime ministers, parliamentarians and congressmen and senators, they're all puppets, with the rare exception. Absolute puppets. We don't respect them. We revile them. And even if we get conned into voting for the next branded, packaged president like Obama, you know, which cons so many people. Oh, here we go. Oh, America is the greatest nation in the world. Look, we have a black president. Look, doesn't he have nice, bright, shiny teeth? And doesn't he speak so nicely? You know, we get conned, but then eventually we realize, oh, wait, it's the same old thing. Obama is nothing more than another prostitute bought and paid for by the banksters. They're all the same. And ultimately, even if we get conned for a little while, we then realize, oh, it's the same old thing. We don't respect our leadership. And we shouldn't, because there's nothing honorable about them. But that's not the way it is here, regardless of the lies that are being told. Iran has a supreme leader. And this is another thing. You know, we talk about Christian leaders in America. What's to respect about these Christian leaders? What country would Jesus bomb? What kind of Christian bombs other nations? They're not Christians. They're false Christians, but they actually have religious leaders in Iran that you can respect, that live humble lives in modest accommodations and really practice what they preach. And this is kind of hard for people in the West to imagine, but they actually have leadership here that is almost universally respected.
The quality which made Khomeini the central unifying figure and symbol of the Islamic Revolution was that he was seen by all anti-Shah forces as a humble and above all honest man.
So here in Tehran on the anniversary of the revolution, and I'm wondering to myself what Western government could get 2-3 million people out in the streets, not in protest but in support of the revolution, of the government and the nation that comes from that revolution. It's just not possible. The hypocrisy of the West, it just doesn't even satisfy the reality. Hypocrisy, it's beyond hypocrisy. There is no government in the West that has this kind of support. And yet we have the nerve to threaten this nation and all of its people. Time to wake up.
Grand Ayatollah Khomeini, the architect and the face of the Iranian revolution.
Here's the truth that you don't know, most Americans, Westerners don't know, and this is true, and you need to soak this up. The supreme leader has issued a decree, a fatwa, making clear that in the eyes of Islam, keeping in mind this is an Islamic leader of the most honor and integrity that you can imagine, who lives consistent with the values of Islam, a decree has been issued by the Imam Khomeini, that nuclear weapons are basically an affront to God. They are a crime against humanity. And therefore, Iran cannot pursue a nuclear weapons program because it would be an insult to God.
اعتقادی ما، مبانی دینی ما به کار بردن این گونه وسایل کشتار جمعی اصلا ممنوعه، حرامه. این ضایع کردن حرس و نسل که قرآن او رو ممنوع کرده.
And if you think about this, that makes perfect sense, doesn't it? How would God want anyone to create nuclear weapons? What sane individual would interpret God's creation as sanctioning the production of nuclear weapons, much less the use of nuclear weapons? Well, this is how twisted we've become. We've lost our humanity. We've become so indoctrinated that we cannot see the truth, even though it stares us right in the face. It is insane that anyone would pursue the production of nuclear weapons. And the United States, my birth nation, has not only produced nuclear weapons, but has used them twice. And I've been to Hiroshima and Nagasaki, and I've seen the effects of this hell on earth that we created. So, you know, we are the problem. Iran is not the threat. We are the threat. We in the West, in our puppet governments, we are the threat. We're the ones that have the nuclear weapons. Us, Israel, hundreds of nuclear weapons. Samson option Israel, threatening to exterminate the world, quite frankly, if it feels its existence is threatened. And Israel ain't gonna be around much longer, so is it actually gonna carry out that threat? We in the West are the real threat to this world. We're the biggest hypocrites on the planet, and the fact that we're targeting Iran, a nation that has not attacked another nation for centuries, the only war that it's indulged in has been a war purely of self-defense in which Iraq, our little attack dog under Saddam Hussein, who was heavily armed by us and supported by us, not just the US, the West, and even Russia, attacked Iran, and it was the Iranians who defended themselves and lost many, many lives, probably a million lives. We're the threat. Iran is not the threat. So let me tell you one other thing about Iran that I've noticed while being here. First off, you don't see that many police or military at all. You don't see many at all. But when you do, they're pleasant. You know, they're not threatening or foreboding. Another thing, Tehran, this city has about 17 million people in it. You know how many rapes and murders are in this city on a daily basis? Basically zero. Zero. Imagine that. I want you Americans in particular to imagine having a city with 10, 15 million people and watching the news and not seeing this murder, that rape, this murder, that rape, this kidnapping, because that's all the first 10, 15 minutes of the news is in American cities with that many people. Imagine a woman, your mother, your sister, your wife, being able to walk the streets of a city in America with virtually no threat of being raped or murdered, because that's what they have here. And there's one more thing I want to say about Iran. There's a quiet confidence of the people here. In the West, we're not confident at all. We're deeply insecure. And the way we cover our insecurity is by projecting outward with our corrupt politics and our military. This is what we do. In Iran, it's different. There's a quiet confidence to the people here. And as per usual, as has been my experience in Iraq as well, and certainly in Palestine, I have been blessed immensely with a tremendous amount of hospitality and generosity, a warmness, an openness, an honesty. And, you know, this month that I've spent in Tehran, it has been a real, real blessing. And I hope somehow, some way, that the American people in particular, but the West in general, comes to realize the truth about the lies that we're being told, because Iran is not the threat. We need to take care of our own house. We need to get our own government sorted out, because in particular in America, the enemy is well inside the gates. And you know what? Iran has the same enemy we do. Zionist Jewish supremacists who run the United States government. That's an enemy. That's an enemy inside our gates, and it's the same enemy that's threatening Iran as well. It's time to sort this mess out. We need to clean our own house and stop looking at other people and sticking our noses in their business. Let's get real. Let's take care of our own house.
His Excellency Benjamin Netanyahu, Prime Minister of Israel.
A nation can survive its fools and even the ambitious, but it cannot survive treason from within. An enemy at the gates is less formidable, for he is known and carries his banner openly. But the traitor moves amongst those within the gate freely, his sly whispers rustling through all the alleys, heard in the very halls of government itself. For the traitor appears not a traitor. He speaks in accents familiar to his victims and wears their face and their arguments. He appeals to the baseness that lies deep in the hearts of all men. He rots the soul of a nation. He works secretly and unknown in the night to undermine the pillars of the city. He infects the body politic so that it can no longer resist. A murderer is less to be feared. The traitor is the plague.